Yeah, so there's a possibility that some of you might have interested in some other seminars, couldn't join here and there. So that possibility is there. Actually, it has to happen. This seminar webinar has to happen last Sunday, but could not happen anyway. I can see here 50 participants now, and at the onset, I'm warning you, I'm not going to show you any photograph taken by me or by Prathamesh or not from internet. I'm going to talk on taxonomy, that is a science of classification. Okay, so as Prathamesh said, it will be a little bit of technical session with technical terminologies. So I hope this number 50 participants remain at the end. Okay, let's see. So I'm going to share a PPT actually, which I have converted to PDF, because when I convert it to PDF, it becomes presentable size. So I'm going to share my screen now. Okay, before going that, about taxonomy, it is a science of classification. Okay, Prathamesh, let me, anybody of you can ping me in between if I'm not audible.
Perfect.
So because I can hear that I'm talking, but I don't know whether it is going across. So taxonomy is a branch of science that is used everywhere, and it is a science of classification. All of us, we use taxonomy in everyday life, and it is used unknowingly. Okay, so what do you mean by classification? Classification is a phenomenon where you put segregate things based on their whatever characters or whatever. Now here I'm not talking about animals, I'm talking about things. So it's like in your cupboard, you classify things, you put your party wear separate, office wear separate, shirts separate, pants separate, or whatever. Okay, same thing happens in our kitchen as well. Okay, your mother or your wife or whoever has kept things in their place, and she has already classified them. Okay, so that is taxonomy. So we are using it in everyday life unknowingly. Okay, so here is the presentation that will take you through the basics of taxonomy. I'll share the screen. Yes. Is it visible?
Yes.
Okay. Now, this is the cartoon I got on the internet. I have given the link at the base. So the person here you can see is like somebody novice like me. So when I see a bird, I'll just see a brown bird, brown little bird. But when I ask a taxonomist like Prathamesh, he will ask me different things. Like, what is the size of the bird? What is the beak? How is the beak? How is the iris? How is the eye color? How is the nape region? How is the tail? So that is a taxonomy. So when Prathamesh is asking me details about bird, in his mind, he has already started segregating the birds. Okay, he has already started deducing the bird. So if I say brown big bird, he will eliminate all the smaller brown birds, and he will concentrate on probably birds like owl or kite or something. Okay, then he will ask me for the beak, for the tail. So that is the taxonomy. So we are using it every day unknowingly. Okay, and what we use when you go for birding, I hope everybody here, most of you are birders. So when you go to the birding trip in the forest or whatever, you see them through the binocular. Your mind already has started segregating the birds. So when you see a white bird, you immediately come to a vader section, because you don't get forest bird that white. Okay, so you come to vader sections, then you concentrate on beak or the height of the bird, legs or whatever. Okay, so you already have started taxonomy in your mind, and that taxonomy is of the common name. So you may say it is a common little egret or cattle egret or whatever. Okay, so here I'm going to talk something about little bit about technical terminologies, and this taxonomy nowadays, it is called as the science of it is a I mean, it is not favored by people. Because when we talk of binomial nomenclature, people are afraid of it. I know many friends of mine who left biology just for the fear of the names. I hope many of you are here also afraid of names. Actually, the language in biology, of course, it is English, but the terminology or the names given to the different parts of the plant or animal or the scientific name, they have their origin in Latin or Greek, because that study started long ago during Greek or Roman time, Latin time. Okay, so those names are Latin. Even if you go to medical, the terminologies are a bit alien to you because they are Latin and Greek. Okay, so the teacher from whom you understood the biology should have actually explained the terminology, but that normally doesn't happen. So that's why you get a fear of those names. Okay, I mean, you can do integration easily, but if we ask you to tell different parts of tissues in plants, you will get fumbled because of the names. Just because of the names. In mind, you may know the figure. Okay. So, taxonomy nowadays is a bit of dying science because not many people are interested in it. But remember, taxonomy, without taxonomy, you cannot proceed further in any aspect of the biology. Just I'll give you an example. Like haldi, halad, okay? Now, all of us, we are using that for since ages, okay? For our medical, whatever purpose, cooking and all that, okay? There was a patent filed by American company for the component in that haldi. You cannot defend haldi outside abroad just by saying that it is haldi. You have to give a scientific name to it, okay? So, because haldi, here we call it haldi. In Maharashtra, we call it halad. If you go to, say, Assam, it is called by some different name. So common names vary, but taxonomical names are universal. Like we say tiger in English, vagh in Marathi, bagh in Hindi, puli in Tamil. Okay, but Panthera tigris is throughout common throughout the world. Okay, so for example, haldi is... when you are defending it outside somewhere, you have to say curcuma, whatever species is. Okay, you just can't say we are using haldi for so many ages. So you have to defend by using that taxonomic name. Now, suppose if anybody takes out any chemical from any plant and you can use it for some medicinal purpose, so you just cannot say it is from tulsi. Okay, it has come from some, you have to give the taxonomic or Latin name of that species. So unless and until you know that origin of the chemical, you cannot go ahead. You can say that you use tulsi for curing flu. But which tulsi? There are different tulsis available. Okay, so you have to know the taxonomic name. So taxonomy has provided a skeletal framework for the development of biology. If taxonomy wouldn't have evolved, nothing has been evolved. I mean, you couldn't have evolved up to date what we are today. Okay. So, I think I'll go to the next slide. Yeah. So, all of us know this person. If not, I'll just introduce. This is a Swedish person. His actual name is Carl von Linné. His Englishized name is Linnaeus. Okay. He was the first person to start the binomial nomenclature. Now, what does the binomial nomenclature means? I think I'll show you some of the slides later on. It has a genus name and species name. Okay. Now, he was the first person to understand the difficulty of communicating common names throughout, because he was a Swedish. Now, when you talk to some person from England or France, they may not understand the common name of the plant. Okay, so that might have triggered him to form a taxonomic classification system. So he published one volume in 1735, in which he he gave name to so many animals and plants, 4,400 animals and 7,700 plants. So he gave taxonomic genus species name to them. Okay, then after that he published so many volumes later on. He was a Swedish professor in Uppsala University in Sweden. So, understanding the importance of that taxonomy. So many students joined him, like Fabricius and all that. And they started taking ahead further his work. Here you can see a photograph of this first volume. I mean, the language, again, you will see is a bit different. Okay, so we are grateful to this person that he introduced us to field of taxonomy. Okay, now all of us know, I will not go in much detail of this. Suppose if I give you an organism in front of you, immediately you will start classifying it in mind. Remember, I am not gone into the detail of classification.
You see, on your screen, you will see something called as stop sharing. It's also like hide corona. You know, that hide.
But how does it come up again?
You just need to present here the option. Hota na. Tikadets, when you go, you will again see the stop sharing.
Okay, yeah. Actually, it was jarring in between because I couldn't see something. Thank you.
Thanks.
Okay. So, when I gave you some organism, in your mind, you start classifying it, whether it is a plant or animal. Okay. Now, you know the characteristics of plant. It can produce its own food. It is green in color. It has leaves. If it is not, it should be animal. Okay. So, you already classified it in your mind. So, there were people, you can see over here. So, there were different people who classified organism based on different characteristics. So, again, it is a volatile. Somebody may come with some other scheme of classification and may change the scheme. Okay. At present, we'll not go in detail, but you remember that there are animals and plants. There are different world of protista, the small organisms, not visible by naked eye. Okay. So, the study done by Linnaeus to this classification is called as the treatment. So, how do you treat the animal? Again, don't confuse it with the medical treatment or physical treatment. It is a mental treatment. So, how do you place it in different groups? So, this work is also called as the treatment. Okay. So, of course, this PPT is prepared long ago. So, in 2007, these two, three people, they categorize organisms into these three categories. Okay, so we'll not go in detail of that. Let's go ahead. So, actually, it is Aristotle who first started giving attention to biological world. So, I think those basic excerpts from his volumes are available online. So, he was started describing plants and animals, but it was Linnaeus who actually started a scientific classification. But you know, it started in 1735. So till 1895, there was no rule as such. So anybody can come up with any name and give a scientific name to it. Okay. Now remember, in scientific name, you will find two words. First is genus, second is species. Okay. So there was a bit of anarchy, but kind of haphazardness. So in 1895, something of this by this name was formed, International Commission on Zoological Nomenclature. Okay, so nomenclature is like names. So a committee of international experts was formed. Presently, it is still working. Okay, there's a website you can visit that as well. Okay, so it was founded in 1895. It is dedicated to achieving stability and sense in the scientific naming of the animals. There's something called as ICBN as well. Okay, International Commission on Botanical Nomenclature. Okay, at present, I think the numbers of these members have increased. I am not sure about anybody from India is there. I need to check that. Okay, so its secretariat is based at London, NHM, London, Natural History Museum, London. They have published what is called as the International Code for Zoological Nomenclature. It is available on their website. So it tells you about what name to give, which name to give, what rule to follow, because there are so many rules you have to follow. It's not that easy. Okay. And they publish a kind of what is called as the bulletin of zoological nomenclature. Suppose if I find that there needs to be some amendment in that nomenclature, I write to them and it is published. Okay. So the system of scientific names for animal taxa and the provisions for formation, treatment, and use of those names. So everything is present on their website. So for example, if somebody describes a new species and some haphazard name is given, normally the journal will not accept it, saying that it doesn't fit in the international code of ICZN. Okay, so either the journal will ask you to change the name accordingly, or they will reject your paper. Okay, so this is a central body of nomenclature. Okay, now just for insect, it was given to somebody else. The presentation was given to somebody else. Okay, so in insecta, I'll skip this just to keep you informed. The head is 6-segmented. With appendages like attachment, what they have is compound eyes, mouth parts, sensory appendages, that is antenna. Then 3-segmented thorax. Okay. Then they have 3 pairs of legs, a pair of wings, 2 pairs of wings. Then 12-segmented abdomen. Fine. Okay. I'll go to the next. So in case of insect, Linnaeus was also there. So he classified insects into 9 orders. And what characters he used are the wing structure and the evolution. So it depends on what character you think of importance, and you can classify the organism. Okay. So Fabricius was his student. So he studied in detail and he concentrated on mouth parts of insects. So he classified into 8 orders. So you can see there are different authors. Now this list here is called as we don't call it normally as a scientist, but we call it as an author or a worker. Okay. Now worker, all of us know, is the masonry worker on the road or whatever. But in case of taxonomy or science, the person who does the work is a worker, scientist. Okay. So till 1951, 23 orders were there. In 1938, somebody came up with 40 orders. So you may think that it is a bit of volatile science. I can come up with some character and I can change the skeleton. That does not happen. You have to justify why this character is important. Okay. So this order, number of orders will change. I think it has come down, stabilized now to, I think, 29 or 30 now. Okay. So you can go through the websites and find it out. Okay. So earlier scheme was of something like this. Now I'm coming to the names which you were afraid of during your school days. A pterygota. Okay, now T here is silent. Now a pterygota means without wings. Okay, now in school, if you know only a pterygota, because of its phonetics, you may remember it, but the teacher has to explain you the meaning of it. Okay, now a pterygota means without wings. So there are 4 orders of these insects. The best example you know is a silverfish, which you find in your books or in cupboard. Okay, so they don't have wings. Next is pterygota. So those who have wings. Now remember, a pterygota is not a single word by origin. There are 2 or 3 Latin words fused together. Okay. We'll not go in detail of that. Okay. Now pterygota are the insect with the wings. Okay. So they are classified again into two different categories, hemimetabola and holometabola. Hemi is half or incomplete. Holo is complete. Okay. Metabola means metamorphosis. Now what is metamorphosis? Is a change in the body form during the life stages, during the life. So best example I can give you is a butterfly. There's a egg, caterpillar, pupa, and adult. In a single butterfly species, the butterfly passes through these different categories. So there's a complete change of body form from egg to adult. So complete means holo. That's why they are put in holometabola. Incomplete, I can give example of a cockroach. If you see baby cockroach, the baby looks like an adult, but it doesn't have wings. It doesn't have its genitalia well developed. Ovaries and testes not well developed. Okay, otherwise it's similar. So it is incomplete. Okay, so that's why they are kept in hemi metabola. Okay, so this is a basic scheme of insect classification. Okay, now just hold on. I'll have a So it goes like this. So at the top is the kingdom. Okay, now kingdom is comprised of, it is a big entity. It comprises of so many groups under its umbrella. Now kingdom is divided into different phyla. Okay, phyla is a singular, phylum is plural. Okay, now then comes down to a class, order, family, genus and species. Now this is a species of click beetle. Okay, so I put it from my collection. Now on the field, or actual what you see in life, is the individual species. Okay, genus is a name given by the scientist. It is not present in life anywhere. Okay, family is again given by the scientist. Okay, so at the base of the taxonomy, what is there present on the field, on your table, in your lab, is the individual specimen. Okay, now when you see different characters of this individual and you put it in a genus, now there may be different species like this which have similar character, they share similar characters, so you put them in single genus. Okay, so there may be different genera which shares common character, hence you can put them in a family. For example, you can I can give example of Panthera, genus Panthera, that includes big cats. So there's a tiger, lion and whatever. Okay, so they share some common characters, hence they are put in a same genus called Panthera. Okay, now all the cats, they share some common features, all the cats, right, from your domestic cat to the big cat. Okay, so they share some common features, so they are put in family called as family Felidae. Okay, now there are different okay, family Felidae is kept in order Carnivora, so that includes dogs, civets, bears, otters and so many. Okay, now they share some common characters like presence of canines, because they are carnivores, hence they are put in order Carnivora. Okay, now there are different orders, they comprise a class, Mammalia. Okay, so there are different orders, like you get cattles, you get elephant, so many carnivores, they share some common characters like the presence of hairs, presence of mammary gland, give birth to the young one directly, so many of them. So they are put in a class called Mammalia. Okay, so this is how it goes. Now from kingdom to genus, it is virtual. Okay, and species is real. It is present in front of you. When I say Panthera tigris, so there's a tiger in front of you, but there is nothing Panthera in front of you. Okay, it is a kind of treatment given by the scientist, which is based on logical reasoning, because so many big cats share common features, they are put in one genus. Okay, I hope I am clear that species is a real, genus to kingdom is virtual. Of course, though it is virtual, it is solid structure based on logical reasoning. Okay, let's go ahead. Now this is the species we are trying to describe. I think Harshad, one who is trying to describe, is here online as well. Okay, so this is how it goes. Okay, now this is the name we are given, trying to give to this species. Okay, now it falls under a genus called as the Cryptalos. Will not go in detail why it is called Cryptalos, why it is called Elviatus. Okay, it is based on the characters. Okay, now this genus falls under tribe Hemiripini. So I have given the character here. I will not go again in detail, because those are again taxonomic words, Latin, Greek origins, but you will find some English grammar in between. Okay, so let's go ahead. Now this tribe comes under subfamily Agrippinae. It comes under family Elateridae, superfamily Elateroidea. Then order Coleoptera, that includes all beetles. Then class, either it is called insect or hexapoda, it depends. Okay, now hexapoda means hexa is six, poda is appendages. So they have six legs. Okay, so that all insects, you know, they'll come in order class insecta or hexapoda. Now all of them, they have jointed appendages. You take antenna, you take leg, you take abdomen, you take body. It is made up of jointed, made by different parts joined together. Okay, so arthropoda means what? Jointed appendages. Now all of you know arthritis. Okay, it is not a disease, an anomaly of our joints. So arthropoda means jointed appendages, that includes crab, lobsters, centipede, millipede, insects. Okay, so many things. Then they are part of what is called as the metazoa. That is the organisms made up of multicellular organisms. Millions and trillions of cells. Okay. Now, all of them, they form a single kingdom, what is called as the Animalia. Okay. Now, animal, of course, we are also animals. So, we have well-developed nervous system, central and peripheral nervous system. We have sensory organs. We are free for movement. And we are heterotrophic. The spelling is wrong. Anyway, heterotrophic means we cannot prepare our own food. So these are the basic characters for all animals. Okay. Now, this is the hierarchy as it goes. Now I have put a photo here because this is the real what is in front of you. So looking at the characters, we have put it in this genus. Now look at the suffixes at the end. Okay. Now normally, let's say family. Invariably, all families should end in DAE. Okay, DAE, that is the rule of ICZM. Okay, if you say Accipitridae, okay, then Anatidae, that is gooses, Felidae, Canidae. Okay, so family name should end with DAE. Subfamily should end with NAE. Tribe should end with NI. Okay. Genus and species can vary, it depends. Okay, I hope this is clear up to the, just hold on, I'll charge my laptop. Okay, just a minute.
Sure.
Yeah, okay, so I'm keeping a watch. Okay, so suppose that thing we have to change, I'll adjust accordingly. Okay, do you have any doubts now? Or Prathamesh, I think we'll take it at the end, right?
Yeah, we'll take it at the end, right? That's right.
Okay, fine. So I'll go to the next slide. Now there are different terminologies used in this. Okay. So taxa and taxon. So taxa is plural, taxon is singular. It is the actual, for example, beetle, Coleoptera, either taxon. Okay. Or say cats or dogs. So it is an individual entity. You can call it as a taxon or taxa. Okay, then comes taxonomic placement. I think I can highlight this. Yeah, then comes taxonomic placement, means when you see the characters, where are actually you are putting it. Okay, either into cat family or dog family or into beetles or into butterflies. So that is the placement where you are putting it. Then comes diagnosis. Okay, so diagnosis is like the way our doctor diagnoses your body. Okay, so for that, you have to go through the different characters of that organism. Okay, let it be a plant or a virus or a bacteria or animal. Okay, it can, I mean, since here we are in biology, I'm telling you biological diagnosis, but you can think of when you are searching for mobile, you diagnose each and every mobile before buying it. Okay, so that is also diagnosis. So the specimen has to be in front of you. Normally, I should tell here right now that when you are trying to describe a species, you have to have species in your hand in front of you. So in other words, the specimen or the individual has to be killed. Now that is kind of a brutal thing. To animal activist, but remember, without killing, you cannot classify the organism. Now, why you need classification is a different thing altogether. Of course, you should not kill in thousands to identify that. One or two male, female, that is enough. Okay. So, when the animal, let's say animal here, in front of you, you have to diagnose it. Now, how do you diagnose an organism? So, first of all, you see the color, you see the beak in case of birds, how is the beak, how are the eyes, how is the head. For in case of birds, I think many times you will see in taxonomic description that beak length is longer than the head length. Okay, now you should know from head where, from where to where. Okay, so you actually need to measure the beak with the head. Okay, then in case of again taxonomy, bird, all of you know it is bird beak, but you may find it that it is called as the upper mandible and lower mandible. Okay, so it is also called as the mandible. Upper, don't call it upper beak or upper half or lower half, that is a common terminology, but if you are describing it, upper mandible or lower mandible. Okay, then you may find out the length of the neck, breadth of the neck. Okay, then characters of the primary feathers, secondary feathers, breadth, wingspan, legs, so many things you have to have taken into consideration, and that is called as a diagnosis. Okay, now for example, my thesis is not online, but I used to identify something like 50 or 60 characters of a beetle. Now you can imagine a beetle of say 10 millimeters, 1 centimeter, 2 centimeters. You have to go deep into that, go through, see through the microscope, and jot down 50-60 characters. Now, in case of birds, probably you can identify from the photograph. But for reptiles, for snakes, for lower animals, for insects, you cannot do that. Okay? You have to have specimen with you. So, for in case of beetles, you need to kill beetle. That is, it's not good for, some people may think that is not good, but we are not killing in en masse. Just one or two individuals. Okay, so that is the diagnosis. So once you diagnose it, you designate it, means you come down to some conclusion. Okay, this is the character, hence you have to put it in this phylum, put it in this genus, or this is the species. Okay, so taxonomic placement and designation is somewhat synonymous. Okay, then this is a bit confusing. Okay, type. Now I'll tell you about holotype at the moment, because about bird. Let's say there's a bird called Bugun Leo Sichla, okay, which was described from Arunachal 13, 14 years ago. So that bird, which is in your hand, a dead specimen in your laboratory, from which you are describing a species, is called as the holotype. Okay, single individual, it may be a male or female. Okay, so that has very immense values, because your publication, which is going out to be in public, the characters of that bird, they are based on a single individual, what you call it as a holotype. Now this holotype has a lot of value. If you economize it, it may be worth billions of rupees, because if that holotype is lost, your description or your publication becomes invalid, because you have lost the specimen. So somebody may come out and ask, how do I compare the next specimen if I have? I cannot compare with the photograph. I need to have your holotype for comparison. So if you have lost it, it is a bit troublesome. Okay. Of course, you have multiple specimens in your hand. So when you describe a species, you have to designate one individual, either male or female, as a holotype. Then you can come to the next paratypes, paralectotypes, syntypes, etc. Okay, I think it is there in the next slide. I'll tell you later. Okay, so there's a type specimen. So it is an individual from which taxonomic description is given. Okay, then type locality. Here, remember, type means the specimen. Okay, nothing to do with the typing. Okay, so type locality means the geographical location from where the specimen was collected or from where it is found. Okay, so just hold on, my PC battery is running down. Yeah, okay, so from where the specimen is collected or where it is found. For example, which I can give you, let's say Panthera. No, I'll give you Gyps bengalensis. Okay, so bengalensis means what? The person who first identified, probably Linnaeus, I don't know who. So the type specimen which he got it from some other person, that person might have told that I have collected this specimen from Bengal. So he gave the name Gyps bengalensis. Now Gyps means vulture in Latin or Greek, whatever. Okay, so that is a type locality. Okay, then depository means when you have specimen in front of you, it is killed, dead, you just cannot forget that specimen. You have to submit it to some bank. Bank as in not the economy bank, but there is what is called as a depository or a museum, in other words. So there are plenty of museums abroad where they accept specimens and they preserve it. Okay, now let's say in case of London Museum, which is the largest probably in the world, they have, I don't know, they have not counted their specimens, but maybe in the scale of 50 millions or something. Okay, so they keep that specimen which you give it to them and they preserve it. Okay, now here in case of India, you can deposit specimen to either ZSI, Zoological Survey of India, or BNHS in Mumbai or NCBS in Bangalore. Okay, ideally you should not keep it with yourself at home. That practice is allowed in Europe. And
One minute. I think somebody interrupted with sharing their screen, so you will have to do a screen share again.
Okay.
Satvik, I think it was from your side. Try and avoid it, please.
Is done?
No, I think we are yet to see it.
I think 4 minutes left. Let's wait for notification for Google. Yeah, so in the meantime, I was, you can listen to me. In the meantime, so you have to deposit a specimen to some depository. So where it will be available in the future. Amol sir, Vedant has seen. So shall I resume my presentation?
Yeah. Surprisingly, I'm not able to see it. I don't know. Now it is.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so it's like, suppose you have collection at your home, personal collection. And if you die or if it gets lost, so it's of no use. So if you have holotype in your collection, and you are dead in between, or you have not given it to somebody, it is lost. So it's better to give it to some depository. They will maintain the collection for future reference. So suppose, like many of you, you know, the reptile people, they go to BNHS or NCBS to compare with the old specimen deposited by British people. Okay, so that is a depository. Now there is what is called as the label data, means when you keep the specimen, you have to keep all the details with that. I think in next slide I can show it to you. Then there is what is called as the preservation. I think 2 minutes left for 7 p.m. Let's see. So preservation is like you have to preserve the specimen. Okay. If you have, see, there are two types of preservation: wet preservation and dry preservation. Okay. So in case of wet preservation, normally you use formerly people used to use a liquid called as the formalin. Okay, but formalin has a lot of drawbacks. It decolorizes the specimen. The specimen become very hard and you cannot take out DNA from it. So nowadays, normally 70% alcohol is adopted. So you can take out a piece of muscle or whatever from the specimen and use for your DNA analysis. Okay, so that is wet preservation. And in case of dry preservation, you literally, it's like a mummification. Okay, you dry it. But before drying it, you have to give a posture to it. For example, if you're drying a plant, you have to press it, normally what you call it as a herbarium. So you have to keep the plant in a, such a position that all leaves are separate. Of course, not detached from the main stem, but they are separate. You can see the basic characters. And suppose there's a flower, it is in good inflorescence. So you have to keep the natural position as far as possible. Natural as in how it is found in the nature. So in case of insect, we call it as a relaxing. Okay. So when you kill the insect, they cripple. Okay. So they put their legs together when they are dying. So you just can't dry preserve that. So what you have to do is you have to again make it wet and give normal position where you can see all the characters in future. Okay. But remember, there is what is called as the wet preservation and dry preservation. So then there's the author. In many of the publications, you'll find that there's a genus, species, followed by a name of the author. In case of Linnaeus, normally it is written as L-I-N-N. Okay, full stop. And there's a year. Okay, so there's a standard practice to give the name of the author after the scientific name. So there's a system called as the binomial nomenclature, where you use genus and species. Okay, then there's a trinomial nomenclature. It's not very common practice, but where you can use the subspecies or race concept, something like that. But it's not, it may not be valid. Okay. Is Prathamesh is 7-1. Do you have any notice from Google?
No, nothing actually. So I'm happy. Let's continue.
Yeah, let's continue. Okay. Now, if you describe a species or a genus from a single species, so it is called as a monobasic. Okay. For example, in case of bird, I can give, I forgot the this thing. You know, there's a crab plover. Now, the crab plover is a monobasic taxa. Means it's only single species, it's only single genus. Like if you go to egrets, there are in egreta genus, you will get multiple species. Okay. So if there are two species, you call it as a dibasic. More than two, you call it as a polybasic. Okay. So I hope I'm clear. Okay. Now, when you are describing a species and you are publishing it in a journal, you have to give a justification why the name has given so. Okay. For example, Gyps bengalensis. So, why bengalensis? The author has to clearly state that the species is described, given name based on its type, locality, dash, Bengal. Okay. Suppose you are, if you are giving a name to, dedicating to some person, you have to specifically mention it that this species is dedicated to so and so. Okay. Now remember, you cannot just give names as randomly as it is. I think I'll give it in the next coming slides. Okay. And then next is the key, which is very, very unique feature of taxonomy. It is very interesting. We'll see at the end of the presentation. Okay. So these are the some basic terminologies which I have talked upon. Okay. Next is a photograph, which I am going to show it to you. I showed you a photograph of one species which we are trying to describe. So we wrote to a few museums and they sent us this photograph. There are plenty. I'm showing you one or two. Okay. So if you go to the previous slide, remember this label data. So this is what it is, label data. Okay. So now here you can see, is my cursor visible?
Yes.
Okay. Now here you can see a photograph of a dorsal side, that is upper side and lower side. Okay. Here you can see there's a pin inserted into the, through the beetle. Now again, those who are animal activists, this is a cruel thing. Now remember, we don't pin beetles when they are alive. You have to kill them. Okay. Now killing is also a bit of, anyway, I'll not go in later. So you have to pin the specimen. Okay. Now, when you are pinning the specimen, just below the pin, below the specimen, you have to give all these details. Okay. Now, can you see some sign over here? This is the sign for the female. So, the person who identified the species identified the gender as well, and he has written it on this label. So, it is a female. Now, here is a red, orange type written over here. So, this is a holotype. Okay. Hopefully, it is holotype. Normally, it is, there is a practice to write holotype or syn type or paratype. At the moment, let's presume that it is a holotype. So, this is the individual from the from which the species is described. Okay. So, this is the name of the species, Allaus linceus. Okay. So, it is here it is written as type. Okay. Now, here you can see locality is mentioned, North India. Okay. Now, North India becomes very vague in today's context because there are different localities within North India. Okay. And who has done it? There's a name written over here, abbreviated. Okay. Over here. Now, this specimen was in the personal collection of this person. There was a person called as a Jansen. Okay. So, he held this collection and donated to British Museum in 1903. Now, this is the 130th specimen from his 1903 collection. Okay. So, this is what is called as the data label. And here you can see a specimen called as the Allaus speciosus. And the person probably thought that it is variety because it is not matching with the original description. 99% characters match, but there is some slight variation. So, it can be individual variation. So, he has put a question mark by writing VAR. Okay. Now, Allaus speciosus was name given by Linnaeus. So, you can write, see over here, L-I-N-N. Okay. Then, it was from Masson's collection. Okay. This is the locality, Palni Hills in South India. Okay. And this is the height. Okay. 5,000 to 7,000 feet. And you can see Lai, I don't know how to pronounce it. It is the name of the collector who collected the specimen. So this person collected the specimen and that specimen came to Masson, or he has purchased it, bought it or whatever. And then he identified it as a whatever, Allaus speciosus. So this is the data label. This everything has to go with the specimen. Now, in case of reptile, you have to preserve it with into the alcohol. So, on that bottle, you have to write everything, okay, right from who collected it, who determined it, or who identified it. It is a male or female, locality, from where it was collected, and date. Okay, here, unfortunately, date is not mentioned, but you have to mention date as well. Okay, now there's a format how to write date as well. Okay, let's see if I have it in further slide. Okay, so this is a description of a type. I'll just read it. We'll not go in much detail of it. So, holotype, the specimen from which the species is described, male or female. Okay. Also sometimes called as the type specimen. Then, paratype, other specimens taken into consideration while describing the species. Means, suppose, if you have got one bird and you think it is new, so you may describe it as a new species, but after a few years, somebody may come up and say that, no, it is not a new species. It is just a geographical variety of whatever described species. Okay. So it's better you compare your holotype with some other specimen to stabilize the character. Suppose in case of bird, the beak length is crucial. So you may have found out that beak length is longer than the head. You may think that it is a new species, but wait, compare with the other specimens to stabilize that. You may find that the specimen in your hand, what you think is new, is actually a geographical variation. Okay, so you need to have a paratype in front of you to stabilize the character. Then neotype means by accident, suppose the original holotype is lost. Okay. But you have different paratypes or different syntypes with you. You can choose any one specimen, from it and designate it as a holotype. In that case, it will not call it, it will not be called as holotype, it will call as a neotype. Neo meaning a new. Okay, neotype. Okay, then syntype. One or more specimens listed in description when no holotype is designated. Okay, so these are the specimens the author have taken into consideration but has not designated holotype. Okay, then lectotype. So if you describe a specimen species picking up one individual from syntype, you call it as a lectotype. Okay, the remaining specimens, they become paralectotype. Okay, now it's a bit confusing, don't give a big thought on it. Okay, unless you enter into it, you can't do it. Okay, even for me, it is a bit confusing. We have to go through that code on and off. Then hapentotype. Okay, so sometimes it is difficult or you don't have specimen, but you can describe it from some life stage. So you can describe a pupa of a butterfly. Okay, so that becomes a hapentotype. Or it is also used in case of a smaller organisms like protista, means organism which you have to see through microscope. In that case, it is not possible to identify so many characters. Okay, anyway, so that is a type. Okay, now we'll come down to what is called as the key. Okay, now if you go to the older volumes of taxonomic descriptions, there are keys given. Okay, normally they are called as the dichotomous keys. Keys start taking into considering two characters at a one time. Okay, now what is a key? Keys are developed to diagnose the specimen under consideration with systematic elimination of characters. You have to go on eliminating the characters. Okay, so there is a starting point. Then you go on building up the key. Okay, it is usually based on morphological characters, either male or female or both. Okay, now you can start the key with one common character, and that character has to be common to all species which you are considering. Don't confuse with tiger with dog. Okay, so suppose you are studying some geckos. Okay, Hemidactylus, for let's say. So there should be some starting point, and Hemidactylus have some common character is their claws, their digits are into two parts, the papillae, that is the adhesive sticky parts, they are divided into two parts. So that is the common starting characters for Hemidactyl. Then you go on building up the next elimination parameters. Okay. Then there are different states. Okay. Okay. Hold on. I'll explain. Okay. I'll explain it later. Now it works on the states. So either the character is present or absent. Okay. Or it may be modified. So as I gave you example of a beak. So you think that it is a modified version of the character. Okay, there cannot be intermediate. It has to be present or absent. There's nothing different. Okay. Then the key is very easy to use. Okay. Then you can develop keys to order, families, genera, species, whatever you can. Okay. Like when I do this exercise in the class, I ask student to develop keys based on gender or based on, say, hair color, or based on mobiles. Like, for example, I think 50 of us are here. Now I can start the character based on mobile. Okay. Now, first part here is either mobile is present or absent. Normally absent is not there, but some of you may not have it. Okay. Next is the model. Okay. The either it is Samsung or Lenovo or iPad or whatever. Okay. So you have started eliminating, correct? So it is like here. So this is the key. I can share it with you. this key I developed in in my thesis. Okay, so I gave key to Indian genera. Okay, I can give it to species as well. Okay, so all of them, they share one common character. There's a cete. Cete manje, cete means kind of hair. Okay, at the base of the claws. You know, insects have claws. Okay, at the base of their legs. So at the base of the legs, either cete is absent or present. Okay, if the character, the cete is present, you have to jump to the next number, that is after this, number 2. Okay, if the cete are there, they are present, you have to jump to 29. Okay, so it one is goes after, like after this will come 2, then 3, then 4. Okay, so you go on jumping to the higher number by eliminating the characters. Okay, so now the keys can be stable as well. Just hold on. There's a lot of parakeet noise. Last time also this happened. I kept window open, but I hope it is not disturbing. What I was telling. Yeah, so you can develop keys based on whichever character you can think. But remember that key has to be stable. Means, like in this case, if I develop the key, I'm using this key based on claw, ceta. And I'm going to one species. Okay. And if I'm using this character, I should go to the same species. I should not identify it as a different species. So that is what is I'm meant by the stability of the key. Okay. It should not vary with the character, varying character. Okay. So like if you are if you are using mobile, it should jump to the same character, the same person having i7, iPad 7 or whatever. Okay. So the character you are using, considering, it should be stable. Okay. Actually in PPT there was a animation. So taxonomy is something like this. Okay. The classification and naming of organisms in an ordered system that is intended to indicate natural relationship, especially evolutionary relationship, what we call as a phylogeny. Okay. So there are different definitions of taxonomy I could found on the internet. All of them, they are equally good, equally valid, equally stable. Okay. Now, evolutionary relationship. Okay. Means all of us know that we have evolved from Neanderthal man, which was our predecessor. Before Neanderthal man, there was some Australopithecus, whatever. So when you construct that relationship, you can construct in this way. Okay. So this is a kind of a, what we call as a cladogram. It is a evolutionary tree. So there was a common ancestor, which was like a myriapod, means like a centipede or millipede. Okay. So then there evolved different insect orders. So still here you can see insects without wings. So it is there. Then there are different evolutionary advances happen, and you can get what is called as a Neoptera, means newly evolved insect orders. Okay, so there are different branches here you can see. Okay, so I will not go in much of the details of this. Okay, so now this each branch, how do I highlight this? Let's say X6 is called as either a branch or a clade, C-L-A-D-E, clade. Okay, now for example here, Lepidoptera and Trichoptera. It is one of the fly variety, not true fly anyway. So they share some common character. Hence, it is given as X6A, X6B. But what is the basic character? X6. Okay. So X6 is the character and X6A is a character state. Okay. So it is absent. It is present in Lepidoptera. X6B is present in Trichoptera. Okay. So again, I'll come back to basic biology. Lepidoptera means scaly wings, which includes all butterflies and moths. Lepidos means scales, and pteron means wings. So the one who have scaly wings are called as the Lepidoptera. If you have caught butterfly with your hand, you get powdery coating on that on your finger. Those are actually minute scales. Okay, that's why they are called as the Lepidoptera. Now Trichoptera means hairy wings. You know trichologist. So trichos means hair. The insect which has hairs on the wings, they are called as the Trichoptera. Okay. Anyway, so this is let's go jump to the next. Now this is I'll just take a break of 1 minute. Hold on, I'm having a yeah. Okay. Now all of you can see what it is. Those are the cats. Okay. Now, in coming slides, I think I have developed a key. Okay. Now, probably we can do an exercise. If you have a notepad and pen with you, you can try developing a key in this fashion. Okay. Now, we go to the photos. Okay. Now, can you start with some character which is common to all these? All of you know these are the cats. Okay. Now, this first one is which one? It is a leopard. Okay. This is a jaguar. This is a lion. This is a tiger. This is a golden cat. And this is a snow leopard. So, can you judge what is the basic starting point for this group? As an example, suppose these are the species in front of you in the laboratory. And you have to classify them. You just can't say this is a tiger having stripes. You can't just say this is a jaguar, this is a leopard. So you have to have a basic skeletal framework developed through your logic. Okay, can you do that? Let's go to the next slide. Okay, now here I have, okay, this is a simple key. This does not entail a specific taxonomic key. Okay, this is just for our reference. I have done that. So, coat is unicolored. You know, in case of mammal, it is called as the coat. So, color is unicolored. Uni means what? Single color. If it is so, you have to jump to number 2 here. Okay. Now, in how many species you will see coat unicolor? Let's see. Okay. Large. Of course, from photograph you cannot identify. I am saying specimen is in front of you. So the species is large. Head region is covered by long hairs in males. So you know what it is. It is a lion. If it is small, male and female alike, coat color darker. So it is Asiatic golden cat. Of course, last time when I had presentation, I had the same presentation, there was a report of melanistic form of golden cat. Okay. Again, I am telling you, this is for referral. This is not a proper taxonomic key. I just want you to understand how taxonomic key is used by using different characters into consideration and going on eliminating them. Okay. So, you started with coat color. Okay. Single character. So, if it is unicolored, you jump to 2. If coat is with some markings like stripes or spot, you jump to 3. Okay. You come to 3. Now, when coat has marking, automatically you have eliminated golden cat and lion. So, those two species are out of your consideration. Okay. So, you come to 3. Coat color with distinct stripes over lateral and dorsal sides. Correct? Tiger has markings. Okay, lateral means sides and dorsals mean on the back. Okay, again, So if these characters are there, your specimen is of tiger. If this character is not there, what the other character is there? The coat with spots. Okay. Now, if that character is there, means in other words, you have eliminated a coat with the stripes. Your specimen doesn't have stripes. You jump to coat with spots. So you jump to 4. I think I did not. Sorry, I don't have kept cheetah over here. Maybe next time. Okay. So coat color with singular and solid spots. Now all of you should know this. Cheetah has spots. Leopard has spots. But cheetah spots are solid. Whereas in case of leopard and jaguar, they are in roseate pattern. Just see how it is. See this. Okay. See this. Means there is a group of spots together. They form a cloud. Okay. So anyway. So coat color with singular and solid spots. Distinct facial cry marks or lines. You know, cheetah has a mark on its face, like as if it is crying. Okay. So it is, the animal is cheetah. If the spots are not solid, cheetah is eliminated. You go to next. Coat with spots arranged in roseate pattern. So you go to 5. Okay. Now, what is that? An extra spot within the roseate pattern. And there is no spot within the roseate pattern. Just see the photograph. Okay. Here you will see in jaguar, it's like a center spot in between this roseate. And there is nothing in leopard. Okay. So this is the identifying character of jaguar and leopard. Okay, so this is how the key works. Okay, it is very interesting to develop key on your own. You may not develop only for animals, but you can develop on your day-to-day things, what you use. Okay, key is applicable anywhere. For example, when you are planning to go for a tour. Okay, so what is the first starting point for a tour? Those who are working, it may be number of holidays. Okay, how much leave you can get. So if it is single day or 2 day, you go to the nearest location. If it is multiple days, you think of next location. Okay, so when you go for multiple day leave, you next point you can think of is the budget. Because single day outing does not involve much of the budget. But if you go for 2 or plus 3 days vacation or field trip, you will obviously think of budget. Okay. So this is how you develop key in your mind unknowingly. Okay. So, and you, while deciding the place for your field trip, you just cannot jump directly. I want to go to Namdafa. No. Okay, you think of vacation, budget, who is accompanying you, because sometimes you don't have proper company. Like Prathamesh, if he's taking outing or to this thing, field visit, he may have very young kids, so he may not go to a very tedious or treacherous location. So Prathamesh will decide in his mind, suppose there are school kids, I have to go to easier location. Okay, so this is the key. We are using it every day in and out. Okay. Now, this is the another feature of the key or taxonomy, you can say. So this is the character. Okay. Now you can have character states. So in this case, we got 2 character states. Okay. Sorry. How can I do undo? Anyway. So coat pattern is a character. Now, what are the 2 different states you have? Without any pattern or with pattern. Okay. So without any pattern means what? Coat is unicolor. So you go to species. With pattern, you have tiger, leopard, jaguar, etc. Okay. Now, other key you can think of is hairs in the head region. If the hairs, I mean, I'm talking of a mane, okay, because mammals are covered with hairs. So, if the hairs in the head region are present, you identify it as a lion. If they are absent, you go to the next. Okay. So, I started my key with the coat color. Correct? You can start your key with the head, this presence of mane. Okay. Then nails, retractable or not? If they are not, it is a cheetah. If they are yes, it is the rest of the big cats. Okay. So this is how it is a science of elimination. Okay. You can read Sherlock Holmes. The author, that is Arthur Conan Doyle, he uses a terminology called as the science of deduction. Okay. So when Sherlock Holmes is behind any suspect or any crime scene, he puts in his front of him different plausible characters or events. Individually think of every event with in detail and go on eliminating. Okay. And at the end, what remains is the truth. Okay. So same is applicable here. So you go on eliminating different characters and you come down to a species that has your own, that has the characters. Okay. Let's go to the, okay, this is not this cladogram I told you. Okay. So this is a phylogeny. It is the history of evolution of a species or a group, especially with reference to the lines of descent and relationships among the broad groups of organisms. So, this is a phylogenetic tree or a cladogram of a primate. Okay, so there was an ancestral primate. So there was an ancestral primate over here, okay, which shared all the characters. So around 50 million years ago, before that, one branch diversified. This is the Lemurs, Lorises, and Otos. Okay, they are primates, but they have different characters. But they diversified long ago. Okay, so here have you gone eliminating things, and finally you come to humans. Here you can find out who is your closest relative. Okay, so our closest cousin is chimpanzee. Next is gorilla. Next is orangutan. Because all of us, we are on the same branch. Okay, even the lemurs and lorises are our cousins, but they are distant cousins. Like some of you might have left your ancestral place long ago, but still there are some cousins surviving there. So it is like this. Okay, so this is phylogeny. So at the end, taxonomy is like this. Okay, so this is like a synonym I told you. So if they are close, not arranged like this, it will like a, if you go into the forest, will appear like this. Okay. But when you apply your taxonomic mind, science of elimination, science of grouping, science of deduction, you will get something like this. Okay. So you organize your clothes together. So you organize your animals like this. Okay. So this is how taxonomy goes. It is not, actually it is required everywhere. Nowadays, people are using DNA sequencing and relating species, but unless and until you know the specimen, how physically it looks, you should not go for DNA. Okay, DNA is like a proof, but when it is possible to classify organism based on morphology, you do it. Okay, I think this is the last slide. One thing I need to tell something about the naming. Okay, just a few minutes more, then I may stop. Okay, so look here. Now, ICZN, International Code for Zoological Nomenclature. So, you have to go to that if you want to read that, refer that. So, when you are giving species name, first of all, you have to remember that species name always invariably by a rule should start by a small case letter. And genus name should always start by capital case letter. Okay. If you do mistake in writing a paper, your paper will get rejected or a reviewer will tell, just do that change. Okay, fine. Then when you are naming a new species, you have to consider a gender of this name, gender of the genus. Now don't confuse with the gender of the individual. I am not talking about male or female. Okay. I am talking about the gender of this name. Okay. Now, normally when name ends with US, it is called as the masculine. So your species name also should end with US or some masculine word. Okay. If it ends with A, it is considered as feminine. So your species name should also have some feminine ending suffix to the word. Okay. For example, mango. Scientific name of mango is Mangifera indica. You cannot have Mangifera indicus because Mangifera ends with A. Species name should also end with A. So it is Mangifera indica. Okay. So normally if you are giving it to the type locality, for example, Gyps bengalensis. Okay. So whenever there's a suffix ending with ensis, E-N-S-I-S, it is normally related to the locality. Okay. Or ending with U-S, like there's a Gyps indicus, Gyps bengalensis. Okay. So when you are dedicating species to a locality, normally it should end with ensis, E-N-S-I-S, or U-S. Like indicus or bengalensis. Of course, there are deviations of this rule, but I'm just telling you the thumb rule. Okay. So, and if you are dedicating it to some person, okay. So, I don't remember the name. Okay. There's one species of flower called as the Impatiens dalzelii. It is found in Karst Plateau. Okay. So, the person who identified Impatiens, it is a terna, okay, the balsam, okay. The genus is Impatiens, so it has to start with I, okay. And the person who first identified it wanted it to dedicate to a scientist called as the Dalzell. So it is called as the Dalzelli. So it should end with II, double I, Dalzelli, or EAE, Dalzellia, okay. So that depends. Okay, so there are different rules for that, and if you want to go through these rules, you can go through that code of zoological nomenclature. But I'll give you a warning, word of caution, that it is not easy to decode it because it is like something like our own rule, constitution. Because sometimes the wording is confusing because that is not our mother tongue, so that may create problem. But it is giving a worth try. Okay. So I think, so that was the last slide. So to end with it, I would like to tell you that taxonomy is very important science and it is required for a organization of your specimens or species or organisms, whatever. Okay. So I think I'll end my presentation here. Thank you very much for seeing through the end. And if you have any questions, we can have.